I know now why some people retire and come to a place like this. This morning, we don't have much time, so I want to jump right into it. I'm going to be able to share three different times with you, and I want to set up the opportunity first. So I want to talk to you really not so much about the nuts and bolts, but I have a passion for lost people. I have a passion for people. I have a passion for God's church. And before I get too far into this, I think it's fair to preface the conversation that I want to have with you, and that is that I love the Seventh-day Adventist Church. My heart is here. Ever since 30-something years ago, I received a flyer in the mail and attended a meeting, walked into an Adventist church for the very first time. Let me just say this, everything good in my life has been a result of the Lord and this church. In 30-something years of being in the church, I was one of those that committed early on every time the door opened, I was going to come. Didn't matter when or where or how, but I just wanted that to be the center. You know, some of us need to do that to stay close to Jesus. You stay close to his church, and usually you can stay close to Jesus. It doesn't always happen that way. But I love this church. I found my wife at prayer meeting. If that's not a commercial for a prayer meeting, I don't know what is. And she consented to marry me and go on a life journey together, and it has been wonderful. Along the way, the Lord has blessed us with one godly daughter. We put everything we had into one child, and all of our love, all of our concern. I've had the privilege of investing 20 years of Adventist tuition. 20 years. It would have been 21 if she didn't finish Andrews in 3 years and do a year student missionary, but she graduated from Loma Linda with her doctorate in pharmacy, and I have the privilege of pastoring her and her husband, who works for the division, two preacher's kids that have stayed in the church and have stayed in love with Jesus, and that doesn't always happen, and so I am so grateful for that. And then just about 4 months ago, she gave to my wife and I the greatest gift of all. Yeah. Now, this is one I have to explain because I'm not politically correct, and sometimes I just say things the way they are. And I've been a part of growing congregations, which means we've had a lot of babies and young people, and people always put a baby in my hand. Oh, isn't that the most beautiful thing you've ever seen? And I'm not going to lie for anyone, and so I try to get out of it. But my feeling has been, quite frankly, all babies are ugly. It takes them a while to start looking normal. Birth is traumatic. They come out all squished and red and all of that, and it takes them a little while. But so I thought all babies were ugly until I met my grandson. So the Lord has set me straight. By the way, what else would a grandchild with two grandparents as preachers have for a doll there is baby Jesus? So it's been great. It has been a wonderful experience. Along the way, God has given me the opportunity to do the greatest thing of all, and that is to devote my full-time attention to his church. I've had a passion for the church ever since I became a part of it. And, you know, I was convinced at 21 years of age that I would see Jesus in the clouds of heaven. That was back in 1983. You know, we didn't think we'd make it past 2000. Hello? I was convinced. And then as you kind of settle into life, you have children, you have grandchildren, and then it begins to dawn on you, maybe I won't be here long enough. And that was kind of hard, but I'm okay with that. I'm at peace with that. That doesn't bother me, but here's one of the things that I have committed to. If I can't be a part of that generation that will prepare this world for the coming of Jesus and live to that day, then I'm going to do everything I can to set up the next generation. I want to be like David. You know, oh, how hard that must have been for God to say, you know, that thing in your heart, you're not going to be the one. We're going to let your son be that. But you see what David did. David had the plans. He did everything. I picture him down on the floor with Solomon, and they're going over models. And it's the temple has already lived in David's heart. And so he did the next best thing in setting his children up for success. And that's where I want to be. I want to leave the church stronger than I found it. I think that's good stewardship. That's setting up that next generation to go far beyond. In fact, that's what Jesus did. Jesus said to his disciples, I'm leaving and I'm going to go away, but you're going to do greater things. That's hard for me to imagine, but I believe in the words of Jesus. He says, you're going to do even greater things because I'm going to go to be with my Father. And so I wanted to say all that to say this, because I want to speak truthfully. The very fact that we're having a meeting like this is evidence that there's something not quite as it could be. You know what I'm talking about. Now, I love the church with all my heart, but it doesn't take very long to look around and to see some challenges that we are facing. In fact, I think they're serious challenges. That's why I believe in what you're doing. I believe in this focus on revitalization. I believe in church planting. I have been a church planter. But I believe our greatest opportunity is to revive and revitalize and regenerate churches. And we need it. Our communities need it. Our people need it. And so I really believe with all of my heart that even though I'm going to say some things that might hurt, just the reality. You know, when you go to the doctor sometimes has to tell you they don't say you're fat, but you know what I'm talking about. You're overweight, you're not eating right, you've got to begin to make some changes so that you can experience greater health. And so I want to share that with you today, where I'm at in my understanding of where we are as a church. But I really believe that there is a huge opportunity. The greatest challenge that the church is facing, it isn't bad theology. Our theology is rock solid. I tell you, every time I preach an evangelistic meeting, every time I'm sitting in one listening to somebody else, when it's over, I want to spike the ball. I just want to say, yeah. That is what we believe, that is solid, and we don't have to worry about our theology. It's not church structure and organization. You know, there's all this debate about do we need unions and what's the role of all. I think all of that is a conversation that we're having, but I really believe we're not having the right conversation. You know, we've got a crisis in Adventist education. You know, I'm a believer. I've invested, I don't even know how much, and I made the promise when we dedicated that fella that if they brought him to Sabbath school every week, I would pay for his college education. The college of his choice, as long as it had a seminary, an Adventist seminary. So, in fact, they weren't there that day, and they got the tape. They wanted to make sure that I understood, or they understood what the conditions were. But we do have challenges in that, but that's not the biggest one. You know, spiritual formation and church unity and all of those conversations that are taking place. The retention of youth and young adults, there's a flight. We just need to understand there's missing generations in a lot of our churches. And it is a challenge, but it is not the most important challenge that we face. You know, how do we reach postmoderns and millennials? And how do we deal with a culture that doesn't fit into, well, at least what we understand is God's will for our people? How do we remain relevant? And how do we show the love of Christ to people that live in different value systems that we have? And I'll even say this. It's not even what we're going to do about women's ordination. That is not the most important issue facing this church. I believe with all my heart, the issue is that we have churches that are not growing. That is the real issue. And because that is happening, we're getting sidetracked in a lot of things. I tell you, one of the things that I have experienced a great deal of is going into churches that have been struggling and beginning to have a conversation about how do we get beyond this. And I have found that churches that are in distress, they make everything else the issue. That it's about politics, it's about this person, it's about that, it's about all these other things. And the real issue is that we're not experiencing the blessing of God. We're not seeing His church grow, and it's hard for us to grow spiritually when we're not growing numerically as well. This is the number, I heard it just again last week. I was at a pastor's retreat in Chesapeake, my conference, and Dr. Kidder was there and shared the number, and I believe it's probably a pretty legitimate number. I've been ministerial secretary for two different conferences, and I can tell you that we have an issue with churches that have been planted, that have grown to a certain point, and then they have leveled off, and too many of them are in fact dying, and we are facing a crisis. That means that overwhelming percentages of our church in North America are not growing. It is entirely possible that you can be a faithful Seventh-day Adventist, live in a couple different communities, attend church every week, and never be a part of a growing church. It seems like it's the exception rather than the rule. And we've just come to accept it. It's what we are. Or worse, we blame God. This is what happened to me when I first became an Adventist. I just believed everybody would want to be an Adventist if we just tell them. If we would just share what I learned, anybody in their right mind would want to be an Adventist. And so I just believe, and the church never seemed to grow. And it was the church that kind of came to me. Some of the church fathers and leaders said, "Now, William, you just got to calm down. You know, this idea of growth, God, you know, God's in control. But God knows we're not ready. And so He's holding the people back." And it's almost as if we're blaming God for the fact that we are not growing as we should. What this means is that we're not as healthy as we can be. A healthy, vibrant Seventh-day Adventist church ought to be growing. It ought to be making inroads in the community. Look, I know not everybody's going to give their heart to the Lord, but Jesus says the harvest is plentiful. He says the problem is not in the harvest, the problem is in the workers. And either you believe what Jesus says or you don't. So I believe that this squarely rests with us. This is why I think we are beginning to have all these other conversations. We want to try to divert, or you know, in visitation and you're trying to clear somebody and lead someone to God, we call it fogging. You know, they throw up all of these extraneous issues, and that's what we're having. We're talking about finance. There's arguments in churches about tithe and use of tithe and holding on and how are we going to use the limited resources that we have, declining attendance. How are we going to keep people from leaving the church? And we think somehow if we can just get them in a room and chain them to the pew that they'll stay. But I'm convinced healthy churches attract people. Healthy churches are places where people want to be a part of. If they're leaving in droves, which, you know, they say 40% of every, you know, 40% of the people that are baptized within a year leave, it's because church is not what they need for whatever reason. We haven't helped them to be discipled. And so we're beginning to have that discussion, the lack of retention, the exodus of young adults and youth, declining school, all this, and church polity. This is the conversation that we have rather than really where it needs to be. I am absolutely convinced that when we begin to move our churches to greater health, the problems go away. Actually, what you do is you get whole new problems. But they're the good problems, the people that are growing in their relationship with Christ. And so the question that I would like to put before us, and one that I have wrestled with, and I don't have an answer, but I know it's better than what it should be today. And that is, in light of the gospel commission and the promise of Holy Spirit power, what is an acceptable rate of growth? What is it? You know, a few times I've attended the year-end meetings and I hear all the numbers and it's all boiled down. It's just a few percentage points. after we had all the people that have been, all the ones that have lost, you know, died and all of that, just barely kind of eking out any kind of growth. And then we have to begin to ask, but are they in the church? You know, the Mercers introduced me as having 70 members. No. There were 70 people coming. There were 400 people on the church membership. 400 people, 70 people. That may be a little lopsided, but it's the norm that we got two churches, one that comes to church and one that stays home. It's that way. So what is an acceptable rate of growth? Should we look at the early church? Look at its growth rate? Be nice, wouldn't it? What about the early Adventist church growth rate? I mean, the church was on fire. I mean, the church took off. We are still a young church in comparison to the other major denomination. But what we're seeing is we're losing some of that steam. Somebody talked about a second wind, and that's exactly what we need. We've done great. We've seen enormous doors open to us. But I refuse to believe that we have to begin to die. It's just like a Christian experience. You know, we've almost come to accept that when people come and give their heart to the Lord, they're on fire for Jesus, they love Jesus with all their heart. But after a period of time, the love begins to grow cold. And we've seen it so often, we just expect it. But I don't believe it's what we should do. I believe every day we ought to be more in love with Jesus. And so just because it happens a lot doesn't mean that it's the norm. 25% growth, 15% growth, what about 10% growth? I mean, surely we could agree that we ought to have something that we can shoot for. There was a book that Andrews University, Dr. Joseph Kidder, it's the only book that I have found that studies Adventist churches. I want to go on record and say this because sometimes we get desperate and we'll do almost anything to try to grow our churches. But the reality is Adventist churches are unique. We do not grow the same way other churches grow. We are message-centered. Christ in the center of it, but it's the message that leads people to unite with the Seventh-day Adventist church. It's not the music. It's not ministry. Those are nothing more than pathways. But at the heart of it, it is the message. And that's what makes us unique. Because there's a lot of people that are attending the Methodist church in the back, and they don't really even know what their church believes. You walk into an Adventist church, and it is very different. And so it is message-centered. So the way that we are going to grow is going to be different than other churches. And so the seminary decided they were going to do kind of a little study on Adventist churches that were growing. And so they decided they wanted to look for congregations that had 5% growth in baptisms and attendance. Because a lot of times what happens is we baptize them, but we never seem to get them to keep coming to church. So while we may have that percentage in bad, but they wanted to see a corresponding, not only bad, but the growth of the church in what was attending. 5% for 5 years. At this time, I thought the churches were about 4,500 to 5,000 churches in North America. They did exclude immigrant churches, first-generation churches that are coming from overseas and others. They wanted to really get a sense of established churches, English-speaking churches. They wanted to try to figure out how many. They called every conference office. They asked for the numbers, and not every conference responded. But this is what is kind of sad. 5 churches met that criteria. Five churches met the criteria of 5% growth for 5 years, each year. And then they said, well, that's not enough to study. So they lowered it to 3%. 3% growth over 3 years. And that yielded 23 churches that they finally did as their sample size. Look, I don't think these numbers are completely accurate. Because they can't be that low. But the reality is they do lead us to believe that there is an issue going on in our churches. You know, less than 1% of our churches are experiencing growth of 3% according to that. So all of that said, I want you to be reminded that we were told last night the church will go through. The church wins. You know that, right? Doesn't mean we're not going to have some challenges. But I think what we have to do is we have to acknowledge it. We have to face it, and we have to be intentional about where we go from here. If we do that, I know God will join us in the work. Is your church sick? The last time I checked, sickness is not a problem for the Lord Jesus Christ. Is your church dead? Because, you know, there's some churches dead, they just don't know it. Actually, some do know it. But again, being dead is not a problem for the Holy Spirit and for the Lord Jesus Christ. I don't believe that at all. And so the difference between a growing church and a plateau church or a dying church, I'm telling you, is very little. It is not as much as you think. And I hope today you're going to hear something that will challenge you, because it only takes one decision, one person, one somebody being willing to champion, we are going to do whatever it takes to honor the sacrifice that has gone before us. You know, every church you walk into was built on a dream. A lot of blood has been spilt for this church, for a lot of sacrifice. And you know, we need to honor that kind of sacrifice and that kind of commitment. And I believe that churches can be regenerated. I really believe that. So since most of us may not even know what a growing church looks like, that's what I want to talk to you about. Growing churches, number one, they know why they exist. That may seem elementary, but it is profound. It is so easy for us to forget why this church right here, was planted decades ago. What happens is the Lord blesses that spirit of sacrifice, that evangelistic fervor that somebody had and said, we're going to reach the people of this community with the Adventist message. We're going to start a church. And the Lord begins to bless and the church grows and you get a nice building and pretty soon the pews are full and you forget what this church was about. It is so easy to do. But God leaves us a reminder. He left us some marching orders for us as church leaders to embrace, to bring us back to the center, to keep the compass pointing in the right direction. We exist to preach the gospel. As a ministerial director, I got to tell you, I've had a couple conferences where I've had pastors that would argue that point, that some churches are not created to reach people. Some just need to take care of what they already have. We can plant other churches to reach new people. That is not the purpose of the church. Every church ought to be a soul-winning church. Russell Burrow puts it this way: churches that are engaged in sharing the gospel with their community are being obedient to the command of Christ. And those that are not, I'll leave that up for you. We see it here in the page one, the first page of Acts of the Apostles. This was referred to. The church was organized for this purpose. Friends, the church is the hands, the feet, the voice of Jesus. We are to carry on the very work that Jesus started long ago. It doesn't matter how young or how old the church is, that is our purpose. We need to embrace that, and we need to know that. And here's what we eventually arrive at. The church isn't for us. That this church wasn't put here for your edification only. It's not about singing the songs that you like, having the programming that you like, making every decision that conforms to your will. I don't know why we ever thought it was should be that way, but this church and every church exists for people that are not yet a part of it. I mean, that's a crazy thing. I don't know very many organizations that are like that, but that's what we do. We are invited into the church of the living God to reach the next person. And so this church exists for the people in this community. It is a place that we come, we meet, we grow, we learn, we pray for them, and then we go out. I don't know why we've ever thought all ministry ought to be in the church, but we've gotten really good at it. Every year we publish names of 100 people or more that are going to do ministry within the walls of this building or any building, and on Sabbath, no less, mostly, and that we call ministry. The real ministry that needs to be done is outside. It's for the people in the community. And when churches understand that, they begin to grow. They begin to realize, suddenly, you know what? I've done more remodeling than probably any pastor. I tell you, because of a growing church and revitalizing, I've done a lot of construction and remodeling. You know what? We've never had a board meeting over a color of a wall or the color of the carpet. Why in the world would we expend resources and energy talking about a color of a carpet? The carpet is going to burn up one day. This is only about facilitating reaching people for the kingdom. And so growing churches are externally focused. It's not about us. It is about them. Can you imagine what your board meetings would be like if you adopted that mindset? That this is not about our personal preferences. That this is not just about what we want. If we find out that the people in our community want to worship at 2:30 in the afternoon, we ought to worship at 2:30 in the afternoon. There's boundaries, obviously, but we need to understand it's not about us, it is about them. And growing churches understand that. They make decisions through the lens of that next person that they want to reach for the kingdom of heaven. When you begin to think about that, then you understand that. Here's a graph I've used many times, and for some people, every time, the first time they see it, and sometimes it's 100 times they see it, there's an aha moment. This is an unhealthy church. What you see here is a model of a church that has lost its course. It is a church that has the wrong purpose. And unfortunately, this is where we are. A lot of churches in North America, this is the way we structure things. It really is about what's going to happen here in about 50 minutes, the 40 minutes, at 11 o'clock. The church exists for that 11 o'clock service where God's people come. We're going to sing the songs we like. We're going to hear a message that is something that we're going to benefit from. And everything revolves around us and our worship. As I said, this kind of church is when they demand full-time pastors. And when that happens and you grow, then they want another pastor and another pastor because we want to be ministered to. It's about us. This is when you have worship wars. We want to sing the songs we want to sing. You know what? I came to Sabbath school today and I learned something. I've learned there's other songs in the hymnal that I've never heard before. You know, I didn't get all in a huff and leave because they didn't sing my favorite. You know, I tell the brother, you know, if you'd sing my favorites, I think everybody would have enjoyed it. You know, I would have enjoyed it. But, you know, this isn't about us. It's not about that. And we need to understand that. So if this is the way we are, this is a dead and dying church. This is a church that will find itself eventually alone. This is what we want. An externally focused church, an outward focused church. When we do this, we cannot help to grow. This is who Jesus was. It was always about the other person. It was always about their needs. It was always about what they needed. And when you put that in the center, I call it evangelism, you can call it discipleship, you can call it whatever you want. But when that becomes the purpose, now we begin to fire on all cylinders. We now know why we're having ministry. Every ministry in the church, whether it's in a local church, whether it's in the school, whether it's in a conference office or a union office, has to look through the lens of what our purpose is. Our purpose isn't to just have church. Our purpose is to reach people. Somehow, we have valued activity over effectiveness. I've heard it, I don't know how many times, and I know the sentiment, but people say God hasn't called us to be successful. He's called us to be faithful. Well, I get that. There is truth in that statement. But I cannot help but to think that if we are faithful, that we will also be effective. That this is, God doesn't give us the gospel commission because he knows if he doesn't give us something to do, we're going to get into trouble. It's not like he just wants to keep us busy. He wants us to reach people for whom he died. People that wake up this morning and didn't have a reason to get in their car and come to this church or go anywhere and worship. They were out all last night trying to find some sense of wholeness, and they're broken. They're broken. This is what we should be about. Caring about, being passionate about the things that Jesus is passionate about. And churches that understand that begin to make that one transition, and suddenly now every ministry in the church has a purpose. You know what? I do all those other ministries, but we do them differently. Because we know children's ministry isn't just about babysitting. Those are young people that need to make a decision for Christ. And we're not going to just put them in front of a television and throw in a film or something like that. We want to minister to them. Socials just isn't about us getting together in our little cliques and talking. It's about inviting people that would never walk through the doors to a worship service. You know, Adventists, yeah, we're a little different. But we're a good group of people to be around. You just got to get to know us. And people that get to know you will fall in love with the Jesus that's in you. And sometimes that needs to be playing basketball or volleyball or doing something that's outside that spiritual kind. You know, Christ's methods alone, you know that quote? He mingled among people, desiring their good. He showed his compassion, and then he began to have spiritual conversations with them. So growing churches know what it's about. Here's number three. Growing churches believe they can grow. You know, I was raised. I got in trouble in ninth grade. I had to leave. By the way, I learned something about Tulsa last night. You know, I lived in Tulsa from 1970 to 2010, and I didn't know about that car. So you got to travel halfway around the world, it seems like, to find out what's going on. But in ninth grade, I got in trouble. I had to go live with an uncle because the public school system said, we can't help him. And so he took me in. My aunt and uncle lived in North Dakota. Grand Forks, North Dakota. You could see old Canada, Dan. That's about as close as I want to come. They have a saying, 30 below keeps the riffraff low. But they let me go up there, and I spent a year, and my uncle was a professor at the University I got in the habit of, I was negative 10. Oh, I can't do that. I can't. You know, he'd always say the same thing. Can't, never did anything. I still remember that. It's been a long time. Can't, never did anything. When you're having a board meeting and somebody throws out an idea, do you spend the next half hour attacking it, coming up with 20 reasons why it won't work? Or do you think about, what are the ways in which we could make this work? What are the ways in which this could happen? Look, Adventists and devoted followers of Jesus, we got Jesus on our side. We got Jesus. I think of Andrew, you know, in that little lunch. You know, here's this little boy's lunch, 5,000 people. I mean, he could have hit a home run that day. And then he said, but what is that with so many? You know what he did? At that moment, he forgot about Jesus. He forgot about what Jesus could do. And I believe that churches that understand that God is on our side, when we align with his plan, that God will go with us. That God will open doors, we will see things happen. There is an attitude among growing congregations, even with Adventism, that book Big Four calls it faith-based optimism. You know, faith is something that you see. You see it all the time. In the Bible, Jesus saw their faith. Jesus saw her faith. It's something that you see because it lives. It moves. And God honors that. Faith is that currency of heaven that opens the windows of blessing, and we can experience that. You've growing churches got to believe that if we hold a meeting, if we start this ministry, if we go out and minister to the homeless folks, that something good will happen as a result of it. Churches that are negative, believe that they can't do or God won't bless, never try anything. Here's number four. Growing churches are led. And what I mean by that is very little happens naturally that's good. You know that? Very little happens that's meaningful in the church just because it happens. God believes in leadership. I don't know why we sometimes, I'm thinking, you know, again, I'm an outsider. I've been an Adventist for 35 years, so I still consider myself an outsider. I don't get, we apologize for leadership. That there is some idea, you know what? I've been a pastor in a local church. I expect leadership in my conference. I expect that the conference will help lead, provide direction. I believe that ought to happen at a union level. I believe it ought to happen at a division level. In fact, Dan Jackson, you know, I believe in what you're doing. You know, I'll just say it. The division staff has grown, and I think that's a good thing. Because leadership makes a difference. Leadership moves things. If we're not going to lead, then we're never going to be able to accomplish the things that we have. Too many churches are just reactive. Their whole agendas are nothing but, you know, problems. And they never lean into mission. They never, they never push it forward. All right, very quickly, I'm going to have to go through these. Act decisively, now versus later. You know the idea, I will deal with it. I tell you what, I'm going to get into some details that happened there at Baltimore First or Ellicott City, and I can tell you everything that I did, everything that I get credit for doing, they already knew. There were agendas, there were committees, there were feasibility studies, there were all that. They had analysis paralysis. You know, they just were so afraid of making the wrong decision, they never made any decision at all, and they just thought things are going to get better. We've got to act decisively. If we believe the Lord's coming, then we need to act and act now. You make a mistake, admit it and go on and don't do it again. Deal with challenges. You know what? I believe in being confrontational. Confrontation is a good thing. It's biblical. Jesus said, your brother has all you get. Go. You know what that is? That's confrontation. That's godly confrontation. Sometimes we're opposed in the church when we're trying to move things forward. We reach opposition, and we just run away from it. And so the church is being held captive by these inhibitors because we don't want to deal with it. I believe growing churches, they confront issues. They confront inhibitors. Sometimes that's our building. Sometimes that's our structure. Sometimes that's people. I had somebody at the front door who should have been the last. He should have been at the back door. But, you know, they didn't understand, and they didn't want to hurt somebody's feelings. And it didn't matter how many people got run off. As long as he stayed there, that's all they cared about. You have to deal with challenges. Here's number 7. Growing churches are praying churches. You want to regenerate your church? Churches grow supernaturally. That's why this is hard. We got to do our part, but God has to do his. If God doesn't show up and God doesn't bless our efforts, nothing good is going to happen. But I believe, look, this God's already on our side. God's already told us what he wants us to do. God is more interested in seeing a growing. I mean, what would happen if the North American division next year started growing at 5, 6, and 7%? I mean, do you know what would happen? I can't even think about the impact that would have on the kingdom of God. And not only that, but how inspiring it would be to other places. Other places that are probably even more challenged than we are. Look, there are challenges out there, but they are no match for our God. I believe that. All it takes is some people that are willing to say, we are not going to just accept what has always been. But we're going to pray that God will go with us, that God will open doors, that God will go before us, and that God will join us in this journey, regenerate our churches. Nothing would be more God-honoring than healthy, growing Adventist churches, not just for the people we need to reach, but the people that are in the church. Because some of us need to be converted too. Some of us, it's been so long since we've seen a miracle. We need to see that again. And so I want to encourage you, hang around, attend some of the meetings that will be happening. Ask God for one idea, that, and then pray for others that God will raise up in your church, and you could be the one to make the decision. A church that's regenerated, it's only one decision away. The power of one decision is all it takes. Let me pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for the privilege today of having this conversation, of beginning to talk about, well, quite frankly, what's going on around us. And we see we're being distracted. There are all of these ancillary issues that are grabbing our attention when really we just need to focus on our Father's business. Father, I pray that you would give us clarity and singleness of purpose. And I've got a feeling that as we chase that, as we lean into that, that all these other problems are going to take care of themselves. We thank you that you are the God of the impossible, that with you all things are possible. Lord, surprise us at what you can do in our life, in our church, and in our ministry. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.